people hank them. Hank, 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 hank. We kiki them. Hank them. Hank, 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 hank. A lot of times you'll be through hunting, killed your birds, limited out what, and they wanting to come in, they'll be there, and you can just, hank, 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 you know, come. Little fella's gone now. I put him to sleep.
Well, now I want to teach you a new technique. I've been practicing it for many years.
Bust him!
I can't eat skeet. I ain't hit ducks all day long.
Man, I'm the same way.
I can't.
I don't blame it on
anyhow. I can't either. I guess I just don't lead them enough or something.
Yeah, man, these things are pretty cool. We just got them in. Tetra makes them. It's really going to help us out in the field. It's going to block the shotgun sound, but it's still going to be able to hear. You can talk to your clients and whatnot. I think it's going to be a great tool to have in the field with us. We're at the range today. We're with the Confluence group. A lot of their families come in from all over. Got the duck hunt this morning, and now we're here at Skeet Range. We're gonna see if we can have a little bit of fun.
Throw a three right here, let Brody shoot. Get in front of it. Pulled up there and stopped your gun.
Hello. Yeah, we're at the range.
Is that illegal?
Yeah, we're doing that piece you wanted done. All right. Yeah, when? Oh, now.
We got three guns running at one time.
All right. I'll see you in a few minutes. Evidently, it's not the only piece we're doing today. We're going to head over to the lodge, and they want to walk through the entire farm, not just the lodge. So, we got that going for us. Cue the MTV crib music now. What's going on, everyone? I'm Jeremy. I'm going to be your guide today. I'm going to walk you through Honey Break, show you a little bit about what we do every day. Come on in. As far as the hunting side goes, this is where it all begins for us. This is where your guides will be in the morning times. This is where it all starts. First night you get here, there's pool tables, ping pong tables, dart boards, whatever, a place to hang out, you know, get ready, put your gear up. This is kind of the playroom. One thing that helps us out here a lot is after everybody's up, they can see, well, here's Cody, he's gonna be my guy today, or here's Landon or myself or Wes, you know. And what that helps is they know a face to look for at that time. So while they're waiting and they get their guns and their ammo and they've got put out, over here in this area will be a full omelet bar. The omelet bar, Cody will be running it. You have cereal, you have fruit, you have water, milk, eggs, three types of meat, whatever you need. When you go from there and you've ate your breakfast, just because you don't want to have all your warm clothes on and everything, so we have a locker room over here. When you get there, everybody, when they get done eating, they'll ease into the locker room, and I'll go show it to you now. In here, for every client that we have, they'll give you a locker number, so you don't have to drag your gun, your ammo, your duck calls, or whatever, you know, your gloves, your favorite hat. You don't have to get it strung out all the way across the place. You've got your own locker to put your hunting stuff just like it was your hunting camp. Put your gear in here. If you need to put a lock, if you need something safe box, put in it. Have it in the bottom. So this is your baby the whole weekend you're here. As far as when you come in, say it's raining or you got a little dirt in your gun, we have a full cleaning table set up so you can do proper maintenance on your gun while you're waiting for lunch or while you're waiting to go out and shoot skeet on the range. Or when you come in, if you just happen to shoot a lot of skeet, you need to clean your gun, here's a good place to do it for the next hunt so you can assure your gun, you know, functions correctly. Well, that's downstairs. That's where we meet. Here's the locker room. Now we're gonna go upstairs and see what Miss Shelley's got for dinner. A good thing we offer here at Honey Break is not everybody can go up and downstairs all day long. So if you come here and you have some knee troubles, back trouble, or you just don't like walking upstairs all day long, we do have an elevator that gets to every level that we have. Y'all go ahead and take the stairs, I'm gonna take the elevator. How was your walk? That's where the magic happens. You kill a lot of ducks, you come in, you're gonna be hungry. Well, that's where Miss Shelley comes into play. Come on in here, I'll show you what's going on. Shelly, what you got going on?
Getting ready for supper tonight.
Good deal.
Tonight we're gonna have grilled pork chops, squash, and carrots. We're gonna have blueberry cobbler for dessert, and roasted potatoes.
Oh man, look at the size of these pork chops.
This is not pork chop.
Oh man.
And then we have our blueberry cobbler cooking in the oven right now.
Between her and Curdy, we're not ever gonna starve here. I promise. Here at Honey Break, its limits are 11. So when you get out of the field and you get done, filled your belly up and you're full, you can come in here to the dining area or the rest area. Couches, television to watch, cold outside, you enjoy a fire right in the middle of it. The deer hunting here is exceptional. Drew Keith knows how to grow them. So you can take a look, some of the stuff's come off the farms before, and kind of put in perspective what you can see here. Y'all seen everything. You saw downstairs where it all starts. You saw where we hang out. You saw where we eat dinner. Now we're going to go upstairs and see the crow's nest. Y'all take the stairs. I'm going to take the elevator. Now you're at the crow's nest. This is the third story of the place. If you don't want to be down in the lodge where everybody else is at, where everybody hangs out, you can kind of have your own study here. If you want to just come up here and sit down, have a drink, maybe sit by the fire and just have a bird's eye view of what's going on downstairs, you can. Overlooks downstairs, you can still see out across the lake at nighttime. The dock you walk out through here, we offer crappie fishing after our hunting trips. This is where you'll be picked up to go. We have a few of our own boats here. You can walk out through there, you can hang out, do whatever you want to do. As we start moving to this side of the lodge, this is where everybody stays. Kind of reminds you of a treehouse. Everything's up off the ground. Walks up through the trees, you can see the moss hanging down. I don't think there's any place like it. At the end of the day, when you've killed your ducks, this is where you come. It's your house in the trees. So you walk down the walkway, here's your separate lodges. Here's one here, there's one here. They're everywhere. So you just walk to yours, have a good time. All right, guys, you've seen the lodge. Now let's go to the pro shop. All right, we're at the pro shop. As you can hear the guns going off behind, this is our skeet range, five stand. If you need any gear, if you need ammo, if you need lead shot for the skeet range, we got you taken care of. This is the pro shop. If you need it, we got it. If you've seen us wearing it, you can get it here. Shirts, hats, coolers, bottle openers, I mean, everything. You got glasses, shotguns, shells if you need it, duck calls, we've got it all. They got everything here and it's so easy to get, I spend all my paycheck here. So I usually try to stay away from here. All right guys, that's the pro shop. Now we're gonna show you where our part is. We're gonna go to the duck shed. All right guys, this is the duck shed. This is where the masterminding takes place. This is where we work on everything. This is where we prep, getting ready for season. Our bikes is we'll stage down here. There's names on each one. Jared, Mark, Landon, Wes, Madison, Cody, myself. Confluence has bikes on the end. This is my bike. This is what you'll be riding on when you go hunting with me. Your two-seater, we put your bags up top, your Marengo bin, your gunnel kennel. It's where our dog goes. Your bags, be back here, you have two coolers. They ain't 20s, they 10s, but I keep them clean. All right, guys, this is where our dogs stay. This is my dog, Deets. He starts work about September the 1st, and he don't end until the last day of January. So he's had a long one. He's ready for a little bit of a break. They mean as much to us as anything. They make our job a lot easier. It gives a standard for everybody else to see. You know, I feel like we run some of the best dogs in the country. Jared Moffitt is the reason of that. You know, he makes sure that we have the best dogs. If you don't have the best ones, then we couldn't run them here. All right, guys, this way, I'll show you the locker room. Here's where we get ready for you. As far as shells, batteries, charging our mojos up, making sure our guns are working correctly. We have a cleaning station back here. Each one of us have a locker. Cody, myself, Madison, Mark, you know, so on and so forth. In the morning while you're spending your time getting ready and getting ready for the hunt, eating your breakfast, this is where we are. This is where we're getting ready, talking a game plan, where we're gonna go, what needs to happen. Where we saw ducks at yesterday, this is just where we get prepared, get ready for you. All right, guys, you saw the lodge, you saw the pro shop, you saw where our magic takes place. Now I got stuff to do, so y'all get out of here.
The National Weather Service has issued a severe weather warning for all counties in the surrounding area. If you have a dog or cat that you do not like, leave it outside. If you're gonna scream, scream with me.
I'm somebody I said they're on. I hit one of them.
Look here. Sure.
I'll show you. I'm about to hit one of these, too. This one. Sorry, I hit three, my bad.
Heading back to the deer stand this morning because I messed up last night. I missed the deer. I don't know if I got some kind of honey break curse going on right now, but I know for a fact I'm 2 for 2 with that gun in the last week. I shot a deer at Oklahoma, and then I shot a deer in Texas, so I'm heading back for redemption. Hopefully it's going to be a different story this morning. Fingers crossed we get it done.
Well, we're good friends of Realtree. We got Tyler Jordan. He's back here. So we're hoping to break the honey break curse that he's been toting around most of the season. Also coming along with Tyler, we got Riley Green coming in, a little country music singer. And being I'm a big fan of country music, that puts it right there top of the list. Ducks, deer, country music. Well, one of the deer that's on the hit list for this week is Old Skint Neck. Old Skint Neck's a buck we're hunting and thought we had a miss on, but the trail camera proved that it was just a little bit of graze, about the size of my pinky, right under his white patch. We're not going to name the name of the hunter, Tyler Jordan, that shot that. But anyway, we're hoping to get him this week. We got one buck we call Drury Jr. He's got the same genetics as the guys from Drury's Outdoors got last year. He's just a smaller version of it. And he's been on the hit list all year, and he's been elusive. And so we think we've got him patterned, and we got Tyler. He's going to camp out on him. It's the third time he's been here. I mean, he is determined we're going to get a deer, and I'm determined that we're going to get him a deer. So we're throwing the camera guys aside. I'm going to try to get it on my cell phone. No pressure, but we're going to get the buck this afternoon.
Well, I'm hoping that the third time really is the charm on this deal this evening, because I'm trying to lift the curse from honey break that I have on deer. The duck hunting's been good, but I think the curse is really my fault. Drew sent me a picture of a deer this morning that was on here last night. Really pretty deer. I don't know if what we're going to call him. I think Drew's called him Drury Jr. the third. So, should be good.
What just happened, Ty?
I think we just got Drury Jr.
What just happened, Ty?
I think we just met Drury Jr.
Let me see your gun.
Oh my gosh.
Hold it.
Dude.
Congratulations.
No, thank y'all.
What a
Holy
deer.
Holy cow.
God, he's a man.
He is huge. I told y'all the shot was good.
It was perfect. I mean, you couldn't have paid for a better shot.
My gosh.
Perfect shot.
Dude, you don't realize how big these deer are until you get up on it. Oh, he's freaking heavy.
Oh yeah, he's heavy.
He's got some mass.
He's got 30 pounds of horns on him.
Holy.
Huh?
Holy crap. I can't believe it. Man, he was the second deer we saw tonight.
He got bigger.
Second deer came out?
No ground shrinkage on that one.
No ground deer shrinkage.
Yeah.
No,
no deer. Thank you.
Yes,
thank you for sticking with me.
Hey, I knew we had him.
He is.
I told you. I told
he
you
is a giant. Watching.
I said, we piled up out there.
What a fine.
He's way bigger than what I thought he was.
He said, man, I was cool as cucumbers.
How old is he, Drew?
Old as he gonna get.
I'm sure I'm glad you did. Thank you.
I'm a car, man.
We finally got it done last night on Drury Jr., which is crazy. I was a little bit worried at first when we first you know, saw the shot. Just wasn't really sure. You know, Drew filmed it on his phone, and but went down there. He went 80 yards, got a dog on him, So pretty fired up about that. Finally, redemption on the big deer here, so it was fun. Hopefully you're gonna have a good morning duck hunting. The wind's good this morning, gonna be clear skies. Got these guys in here with us.
I'm not worried about the weather forecast. We got an omelet bar over here, man. That's what I'm worried about.
Priorities.
Well, we got Tyler, and then we got Riley and Greg. That's about 27 of us going to the blind this morning. We're gonna take turns shoveling people with a honey break van. We'll be back in time getting that and go shoot some deer this afternoon. Right, Riley?
I'm sitting by you, that's all I'm doing. I may not wait on you this morning.
Yeah. Are you going to have a good deer guide this afternoon, too?
Who?
I'm taking you this afternoon.
Oh, you mean?
Yeah.
You going to take me in to the good spot?
Yeah. I mean, you played pretty good last night, so I'm going
to. I cannot wait.
You got to, you know, sing for your supper so you earn your spot.
I'm going to be sitting on top of a hay bale somewhere tonight.
I was thinking about like an old deck. Like,
I got an old pontoon boat that we took out several years ago. We should sit on it.
Dang it, you set me up.
Just a bit outside. Get him.
Somebody I said they're on. I hit one of them. Okay.
Sure.
I'll show you. I'm about to hit one of these too. This one. Three. Sorry, I hit three, my bad. He was a great songwriter. You know, I actually, when I was, I guess in college, won a songwriter competition with him, a song I wrote called Almost Won, and I got a trick to go to Nashville to meet him, which I didn't ever mount anything. I went and met him, and then, you know, whatever. Well, I saw him again. I opened for him at a show in Gadsden, and he remembered me. He said, man, get my number, call me, you know. So, I was just a fan, you know. Doing construction work and playing on the weekends. And I called him. That dude talked to me on the phone for like an hour, just like about songwriting and everything. Super smart guy, real nice. And told me to do as much on my own as I could before signing with, you know, management label. And that was really good advice. It kept me from going to Nashville and signing a bad record deal. You're starting to get a little stubble, man. This is what, 2 weeks? I couldn't grow a beard when I was like 16, but I had some killer sideburns.
Can't grow a beard. I just feel like if you duck hunt, everybody that duck hunts that I know can grow something. I can grow a neared, no beard.
Neared. It's a neck beard?
Neck beard.
That's cool, man.
That's it. Yeah, it's really, really awesome.
Did you get like a fake beard to wear when you duck hunt?
Yeah.
Like dye a Santa beard.
Dude, I would do it.
Get him. Hey, boy, that's the way it's supposed to go right there.
That was awesome. That was pretty.
That sucker looked pretty in the sunshine.
Hey, man, I was just hoping you wouldn't go wait until they all got past me before you said get him. I'm like, hey, man, I spotted him. You got to at least give me a little bit of a head start.
He does now.
Hey, man, y'all know why the chicken crossed the road? Because. Because. Hey, man. Because. That's serious, man. Just because.
Nice.
Can't wait to get on the boat again. I love this cheap and crippled with my friends.
You ain't gotta ask who shot that one. You shoot last and he falls, he got him. And there's nothing going down over there.
You might have shot that one.
I'm just saying, when you're talking to the camera and then the gun goes off and another one falls,
I know exactly what happened. I was talking to the camera, I was doing an interview, getting some B-roll. You were playing with your phone, I pointed out the other ducks, shot the other ducks, and then finished my interview. He was over trying to figure out TikTok. He's like, Demon Friday's got it, I gotta get it. He's the coolest guy I know.
I don't know, man, I can't remember what I was thinking when I made like my first Instagram post. For some reason, you know, this seems like a bigger deal. Like, it's gotta be a statement. I can't just put anything.
Yeah, you just can't put out a brand.
That's my favorite
deal.
Duck.
Ever? Or just this kind of duck? It's like, if it's your favorite and I'm here for it, it's cool, it feels special.
I think I'll call him Riley.
That's cool, man. We'll get him mounted. You can tell here, if you count the rings on his feet, you'll see that he's a four-year-old. And the length of the tine there.
Toenails.
Yeah, but.
Yeah. That is one of my most favorite ducks to shoot. It's it's just either they're here or they're not. I mean, it's not like it's a common occurrence. They're here every day.
That's a hard one to tell flying.
Yep. It's like the old gadwall, great duck.
The gadwall drake.
Yep. The wee John, little cotton top. That's a pretty one to get.
Gadwall's belly's a different color, though.
Yep. Well, you can get all the...
That white on his head.
Yep.
It's pretty.
Sure enough. That'd be a trophy duck for somebody on the wall. You like shooting five-year-olds, all right?
Yeah, I only shoot five-year-old widgeons.
That's why
I'm not going to shoot four-and-a-half-year-olds.
That's why I had to shoot this one.
I'll let you shoot the little ones. You should have seen him next year.
It'd been a good one next year.
Wipe the milk off his bill.
Wish my guy Drew would have put me in a better stand. I wish every dog had a band. I could ride a whole herd for you.
Ride a green. Batting cleanup for Tyler.
Thank you, buddy.
Got him.
Yeah, it's always nice if you help a buddy out. You
I like to make him sweat to the very last day and
last minute, fourth quarter. Got it done.
In the right buck.
That's right. Maybe
couldn't have been a better buck, actually.
No.
He's getting it mounted with the. That's where Tyler shot it.
Is that it?
Yeah.
He didn't quite catch him up on it.
Boy, just a little higher. He'd have been
it. See, I gotta get a mounted where you can see that.
You can see this. Just couldn't see all that. I walked across like, I grabbed it. Like, oh, that hurt. Oh, that. No. That's not skipping it. That's on skipping it.
It's amazing that that's the one he shot the other, how many weeks ago was it?
Let me get you a little more here for this first deer you got.
Oh, yeah.
I'd a lot rather shoot ducks, man. But for you, I had to wade the ditch to get it, go waist deep in water. What all I'll do for you to get your first deer? That's what I'm talking about.
And I wish grandpa's never died. Grandpa's never died. All the words of that one.
So this is your first time duck hunting, huh?
Last week.
What kind of ducks are you hoping to shoot?
Couple coots. One that's got a good big lip on him.
Getting ready to go film the Cahill family. Have you ever seen the movie Home Alone when they're all getting ready to go to the airport and they're rushing around? That's what the mornings remind me like, because we got the whole Confluence group here with their families and everybody's trying to get ready. Here, look, here's Kevin McAllister right here. Kevin! Are we gonna leave you behind today or what?
I don't know. As long as it takes me to get this song, I don't know, probably.
If you're not a morning person, don't stay in Chip's room. If I'd have been ready to box, it would have been with him this morning.
Kevin!
Bud, you got your camera?
You getting your omelet fixed? Look at him.
You didn't catch that.
So this morning, guys, the plan is the whole Cahill family's going to be going out to the blind. We got my grandpa with me this morning, who's been coming down here for quite a few years. And no telling when the last one of those is going to be. He's been in pretty bad shape here lately, but he's still dragging out there at 78 years old, and we're going to see if we can't get it done this morning.
I'm David Cahill. I work with the Confluence Group down here at Honey Break, and we're the marketing partnership of the whole Honey Break Experience show, television show, marketing team, the whole nine yards. So this weekend's Confluence Weekend, which means that all the Confluence team gets together and we get to bring our family and kids in for the weekend and share a little duck blind time with from three generations, from my dad coming to tax kids coming, and it's a pretty special weekend for us. It's a reward for working hard all year for the team.
You know, most people that get to come to Honey Break, they're obviously a lot better well off than I am at 25. Definitely fortunate to have my dad give us this opportunity to come.
This is a big weekend for us, and I'm thrilled to have everybody here just kind of sharing in the Honey Break experience. So we're looking forward to this morning. We've got a real nice break in the weather. We got a good, cool, stiff wind this morning. So we're looking forward to shooting a few ducks and watching these kiddos having a good time.
What's going on, bro?
Nothing. We're about to go hunting.
Kill some ducks?
Hopefully.
What are you excited about this morning?
Killing ducks.
Kevin! You ready to shoot some ducks this morning?
I don't know. I've never been duck hunting, so it's going to be fun to me.
Yeah, this is your first time, ain't it?
No, yesterday was, but yesterday. I didn't see anything yesterday.
Yesterday was?
Uh-huh. I had some just okay guides.
Get in them.
Good shot, Don.
That's the first duck I ever killed.
Don killed him a duck.
Watch them to the left there. They may come back, Drew.
Good shot, Don.
Thank you.
Having Grandpa Don in the bind with us this morning, obviously right after killing a duck, and he's not the quickest to draw up on one, and he always gets on my brother and I for quick drawing him, but he enjoys being in the bind with us, obviously, as long as we bring plenty of food for him to eat, because as long as he's got his food and cigars to share with everybody else, then we're all in good shape.
They talking about you?
Yeah, I think so. I'm gonna go down there and slap him.
Get in him!
How many people you see 78 years old still kill a teal?
First hour it was as fast as we could load. So we got a beautiful mixed bag of got some widgeons and some teal and pintail, mallards, and we've had a nice mixed bag morning. It's been a lot of fun. My dad's here, the kids are here, there's three generations in the duck blind and doesn't get out very much, but he likes to spend time in the duck blind with his family and his grandkids. So it's a pretty special day for it.
Kill that duck right there.
Spy!
You know, there's two things that are extremely important to a duck guide. It's vision and hearing. And when a guide blows his duck call, he's got to be able to hear the tone of his duck call. And so much hearing protection that's used today, you cannot hear the tone of your duck call, nor can you hear your clients in the blind. These camera guys also, they're right in the heat of the battle every day. Cameras close to the guns every day, and it's imperative that these guys wear hearing protection. So it's an extremely important partnership for us to be able to use when professional duck guides are shooting 60 days a year, and if you don't protect your hearing, you're gonna lose it. My dad's a great example of that. He was a duck guide when he started when he was in his early 20s, and we're sharing a blind with him right now, and he can't hear it thunder today.
Huh?
Daddy Don, there's three species different right there.
What?
Yeah, what about the difference of species?
So what now?
Different duck species.
What'd you say?
Different duck species.
Levi Garrett.
Yeah, what about the difference of species?
Red man, beechnut, what's that other?
If he would have had this product today, he would have been able to hear like we can today, but unfortunately that's not the case. So how about that, Daddy Don? Can you hear that?
Got a what?
That's what I thought. It's all about hearing protection, isn't it?
I'm beating them all. All I got right now is heath bars.
Can you hear it thunder?
What?
See, you can't hear it thunder. So it's important for a duck guide to be able to have hearing protection and protect your hearing. So Dad, why those backup fender dents in the back of your truck, where'd all that come from?
Where's what?
Those fender dents in the back of your truck, where'd all that come from?
Now, what do you want to bring that up for to put on? I have never had a wreck in my life going forward. That's the honest truth.
So how have you had all of them going backwards?
Well, there happened to be some trees in the backyard, but I took care of them, had them cut down.
He's always the prankster, always the joker.
He's joking 24/7. He's all the time coming up with something new to tell. And
I backed up and hit my own trailer the other day that wasn't even attached. Knocked out one of my taillights.
What? How'd you do that?
I forgot it was sitting there.
If you've heard it 47 times, you'll laugh on it on the 48th, I promise you.
Does Brenda know about that?
I hadn't told her. And unless y'all show it to her on this movie here, she'll never know.
He's definitely a jokester.
They gave them back to me in a sack, and when I got back home, I didn't have but one cheeseburger in there. My burger wasn't even in there. So I went back up there and nicely showed the guy that I just had one burger in there. And, well, he called the police on me.
So why'd he call the police on you? What'd you say?
Well, I just had some choice words for him and climbed the the counter there to get over with him where he could hear me.
He's pretty quick on his feet. You might hear some stories that you want your kids to hear, and you might hear some stories that you don't want them to hear, but you're not gonna change him. He's 78. He is what he is.
So what does it mean to be able to hunt with your grandkids in the duck blind?
Don't mean nothing to me. I don't know what it means to y'all.
So we got the jokes, we got all the camaraderie, and it's like everybody down here at Honey Break looks forward to him coming every year. I mean, everybody's like, when's Grandpa Don coming?
Get in him.
They shoot him again, he's running.
All spies got him.
Yeah, he's got him.
I killed that one. Down here to duck hunt with two of my grandkids and my oldest boy. I'm Don Cahill. I'm from Marlton, Arkansas, and I own Chick Major's Dixie Mallard Duck Call Company. My wife's stepdaddy was Chick Majors, who invented the Dixie Mallard call back in 1941, and he passed away in 75, and my wife and I took the company over. It's pretty tight, probably needs another car coat.
Yeah.
It's free.
He makes the Dixie Mallard duck call still to this day. Still makes about 100 of them a year. So that's another part of the duck hunting history that he carries on through his legacy that we're lucky enough to have in our family as well.
You need to give me that one back. I could sell that for $150 today.
Well, I made it. You didn't.
I don't give a flip who made it. It's got that stainless steel band on. I hadn't made five of stainless steels in my life.
Well, I know.
It takes an hour to get the rough edges off of a stainless steel band.
I'm gonna come in there and build me one then.
God.
So what is it gonna?
Make sure I'm out of town when you do.
This is what we get, Tyler. See, we do a bunch, but we don't get credited for it. But he just remembers all the negatives of when we ate too much and cost him money as kids.
I'll be glad when y'all have kids, y'all know exactly what I'm talking about.
Well, no, we're going to send them a youth waffle house.
That's excuse me. As soon as they were old enough to pull the trigger, well, they were taught how to hunt ducks and deer and turkey and catch fish.
Well, I definitely duck hunt a lot back home. I mean, it's kind of a family deal. Some kids grew up playing baseball, football. We hunted.
That's back in the old days. I don't drink much anymore. Fifth of whiskey a day would do me. As long as it's Crown.
To say he hadn't been duck hunting until this weekend, obviously that was one of his lovely jokes, because when it comes down to killing ducks, he straight up killed ducks his whole entire life.
Spy. Good shot, Don.
Yep, he made a bad career move, David.
That was a bad career move on that last swing, wasn't it? That's an old veteran, too. He's been here a while. See those old pale orange feet? He's been here a while. Made a little bad career move on that last swing there. You know how old he is, Greg?
As old as he's gonna get.
It's definitely a rarity. A lot of my buddies back home don't really understand it, but three generations duck hunting, for Don to be 78 and still going to the duck blind, that's pretty incredible, especially after his heart attack.
I guess it was about 3 years ago he had went in for a general checkup and had some pretty severe heart trouble and ended up having some complications with the surgery and spent 5 months in the hospital and another 8 months in rehab, and You know, when you're 78 and can still sit in a duck blind, you're pretty fortunate to be able to be here, and we're blessed to be able to have him here because it was touch and go there for a little while.
So my grandpa, he's, to say the least, he's lucky to be with us today. You know, it's just always good to have my grandpa in camp, and we didn't think he was gonna make it out of it, and he was fortunate enough to make it out of it and gain enough strength back to actually still be able to come hunting at 78 years old.
And he's still getting around, making it to a duck blind. He's a little slower gear than he used to be, but that's all right. He likes being able to come down here and see a mixed bag of ducks that he doesn't get to see at home. And, you know, it's still real, real, real cool to be able to share a duck blind with three generations. We don't get to do that much. You know, everybody takes that for granted, but it's you don't need to take it for granted because you never know.
Brenda, when I was in the hospital, I was in the hospital for 5 months. She missed 2 days up there spending with me. And if it wasn't for her, I'd be dead right now. See, I died on them twice. Of course, I don't know any. It's just my wife telling me, said, go ahead and put him back in. I had a bleeder, and I bled out on him and died. And then about 3 days after that, Doc, excuse me just a minute. Doctor came in and said that he's bad. And didn't think I'd make it through the night. But I did. Unless you got kids and grandkids, you realize just how great it is to spend time with them. They just, you don't, when they grow up and get away and get married, you don't see them as much. So it's just a real thrill to be able to spend some time with them and hunt and just to be around them a little bit. You don't have to kill ducks to have a good time. Just being around them and talking to them and listening how they've grown up.
It's incredible, and I can put it to you this way. Anytime Mr. Don wants to go to the duck blind, I'll be there to load him up and go anytime he wants to go. Killed 36 mallards in the timber 2 weeks ago, and I still look forward to coming down here. And I'm gonna have to say getting hunting my dad and my grandpa, this was more exciting for sure. I look forward to it every year.
Yeah, that burrito easing on through you already?
Not yet.
Huh?
I've held your daddy up on the side of the boat with his rear end off the boat while he went to the bathroom in the scatters, and the water just leaned off of me holding him. Said, "Don't turn loose on me." He said, "Don't turn loose on me. Don't turn loose on me." And then I had to go one time, and I had a flat bottom that had the back seat was a live well.
Yeah.
And I just opened my, that was so nice. And that, it took me a year to get all that out of that boat. If I was strong enough to turn it upside down, I'd have turned it upside down to get all that out of there.
What did you go in the live well for?
I needed to go to the bathroom. And you can't squat standing in the water when the water is 3 foot deep.
You'll learn that live well's not a good choice.
It was the best choice available, buddy. It's an old load, flat bottom.
Why didn't you go over the side?
I didn't have time and didn't have anybody to hold me.
I'm going to help y'all out, and I help all hunters out. Look, back up, Chip. I've watched y'all putty. I wait till about 9:30 or 10 all the time to tell. This is how y'all shooting.
Perfect.
Just like that. I ain't seen but one get his head down on that gun.
Really?
When y'all throw it up, y'all just going boom, boom, boom. You got to get that head down on that gun. You got to. If you take this here, this is a rhythm I was taught a long time ago. You see me when I pick that gun up, I bring it to my head just like that. And it's on.
Well, now I want to teach you a new technique. I've been practicing it for many years.
Bust them!
Follow with y'all today. How's it going, Jared?
All right.
We met in August.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Got you another little hang-in with you. All three of y'all going with us or splitting up? All three. Yes, sir, Bob. I'll be ready. We be packing the gear. You ready, Cody? I'm like Freddy, always ready. Sitting on G, waiting on O, ready to go. Like old Bennett, ready to get up in it. Hey!
Jared Moffitt, one of a kind, what a guy. If that guy was any more into ducks, he would turn into a duck. He can tell you how much a duck needs to eat, how far a duck flies in a day. What's that duck thinking? What should I blow at him? What's wrong? He knows his way around a duck.
Kill him. Kill him.
I've known Jared a really long time. I met him through Mississippi. Mississippi worked for him. I worked for some good people, and in those days, you know, you think 1,000 acres is a lot to keep up with and get the food right, but you try doing it on 26,000 acres. That's a newfound respect.
So I tell this to everybody, you zones 10 to 2. I'll call every shot by kill them. I don't really use 1, 2, or 3. I'll say to the left, to the right, up front. And a lot of times they have a bad habit of saying right here. If I say right here, you probably got to just look around a little bit because he's somewhere in the decoy.
I came out here July, first day I came out here, and we started right off the bat. He had me doing all kind of stuff. If you want to know, work for somebody that's going to make you work hard, Jared's probably the one to go to, because I came out here and it was just as fast as I could get it.
Plan this morning is to go shoot a whole tote full of birds.
He works real hard doing what he does. He always keeps us on birds. He plans year round. This is a 365 day a year job. He gets up every single day and makes sure he's out here doing it. I always try to beat him to work. I beat him to work one time. And that was a year ago, and ever since then he beats me by 30 minutes. So he's not gonna let anybody outdo him, that's for sure.
When it comes down to ducks, he's all business. He's just go, go, go. He never stops. He's always on the go. He's always thinking ducks. What are they doing next? What do we need to do to the dogs? What can we do to make it better?
Look, as long as they back here or here or here, you good. But when they break out front to come in, they're not gonna do it. The wind's more coming out of the northwest, so they want to get on the back. But when they get out front, them birds are, I don't think it's a mojo, but we've got them on remote where we can turn them on and off. They're looking dead in this blind. And when you're sitting here looking, you don't think that's a big deal. But when you get out there at that grass line and look how a duck's eye view looks, I ain't gonna finish like that hardly.
He's always fired up. You can't really stop him. When he messed up his ankle this summer, he was still out here in crutches, and he don't never stop talking about duck hunting. That's his way of life. And whether he was out here on crutches trying to be involved as much as he could, not being able to move around very good, but he was still out here doing it.
You know, he's very welcoming. He's full of knowledge and very helpful, and what a great mentor.
In the last few years, I've learned a lot from Jared. I feel like everybody knows a little bit of something. You take the good from some and the bad. Jared's taught me how to be a more open-minded duck hunter. If it's doing this, you know, I grew up hunting in the timber. And now you've got timber, you've got sloughs, you've got breaks. You know, you got everything. It's hard to be able to cover the entire playing field, and he can do it.
He's got it. Ain't no doubt about that. He can blow a duck call. You don't want to be in the blind beside him trying to hunt, because he's probably going to shoot more birds than you will.
He loves telling stories, and there's no one better to tell stories than Jared Moffitt. But he may be mid-story and all of a sudden see a group of ducks way up in the stratosphere, and everything is dropped and all his attention is focused on those birds.
And that's just a shallow stump.
Well, it's a moist soil unit. You know, it's about the largest freshland inland freshwater marsh in the U.S. and about 26,000 acres. More joined in.
feet. And we got four.
My dad started me hunting, dad and grandpa and uncles and all. When I was 2-3 years old, I never get tired of it. Just a way of life, a passion. All my family was farmers then, so when the last combine come out the field and got washed up and put up, we hunted every day. It's just what I grew up around, and the way I knew life was to hunt every day. One time my dad asked a man one time, he said, in the duck blind, you hunt a lot? He said, yeah, I hunt a whole lot. That man said, I hunt 8-10 times a year. He said, you call that a lot? Them boys wing shot 137 days last year. He said, that's a lot.
After duck season's over, it's dogs. So he moves from ducks to dogs, and then it's nothing but dogs, dogs, dogs. He trains the dogs, he works with the dogs, conditions the dogs, takes the dogs to trials, and then repeats.
Got a pretty strong pack of dogs right now. You know, in the kennel, I got a young dog that's a qualified all age, master hunter, one master national pass, Ooh, they busted us. I got Kill him.
Hey!
How about that?
Did you know what they call them ducks? Mother-in-laws, because they ain't nothing but male.
Kid, I started, you know, blowing duck calls and working dogs and competition and this and that. And he said, well, son, if you want to be the best at what you're doing right there, probably kill more ducks than any of them other boys, you're going to have to work while they fishing, riding four-wheelers, shooting sporting clays, playing football, playing basketball, baseball, and you're going to be killing ducks, and they're going to be sitting there saying, yeah, well, wonder why they killing them song guns so good. Wonder why they killing them so good. You're going to get out of it what you put in it. That's the way I'm going to raise my boy. What you put in it's what you're going to get out of it. There's no days off. No.
We've got guides of all walks of life. You know, we're all different. And Jared kind of, he's the dad of us all, you know. Now, if we need something, we go to him. Usually it's taken care of right away.
Well, it will start hurting, buddy. I'm telling you.
It already split. It was split right here and it healed. It was from throwing all the dirt away.
If you don't take care of them pads, when it gets about January the 15th, they'll be so sore. When you reach down there to pee, you'll say, oh, my hands. You won't even be able to reach and grab them. So they're going to crack. Well, I got lotion over there for everybody every morning. Rub them down.
Jared is definitely the dad of the group. Yes, he's very competitive, and yes, he's, you know, whenever it comes down to business, he's all business, but you know, he's the dad of the group.
That saying that you should have been here yesterday, and duck hunting is 100% true. Should have been here yesterday, or you may want to be here tomorrow. Well, I've been lucky and I've been fortunate. I've lived a dream. I've missed about 8 days in 20-something years. I'm as hungry to watch another one fall here in a minute as I was when I shot my first one at 5. I'm hungry, I love it, I eat it, I sleep it, I breathe it. Most people think they like it, but when they come stay with me for about 360 days, they decide they really didn't love it. They thought they did. You know, Honeybreak is a special place. It's a waterfowl destination. It's just sportsman's paradise. And, you know, one thing about Honeybreak is to give people the opportunity and introduce people to duck hunting and give them an opportunity to have somewhere to go that we think is done right, you know. Get the experience of it and introducing kids to it and conservation and managing habitat. You know, it's not just going out there and taking ducks. That's the thing about it. I got some memories with my grandpa and my dad and my good friends when we shot them right, you know. They introduced it to me at a young age, and if you take your kids when they a young age and they have good times, I think they'll keep coming back. But if you take them and don't show them a good time, they may not stick with it. One day, who knows, we'll go day by day. We don't know how long we're gonna be duck hunting. Just couldn't imagine a life without duck hunting. I don't know what I'd do.
Daylight come, daylight go. Now I know you need the dark just as much as the sun. But you're signing on forever when you ink it in blood. A-E-I-O-U-E-I. I use my state of the art technology.
That's one of the first things I love when a lot of people come and I have a lot of people and they say, man, I guided 17 years down at and this, that, and the fourth group of birds come in. Gray ducks, teal. I said, well, that was ringnecks, the first group that come through. The second group that come through was gadwalls, you call mallard. The third group that come through was gray ducks, you call pintail. And then the last group was ringnecks when you thought they were teal. Now, how long did you guide down there?
Well, now I want to teach you a new technique. I've been practicing it for many years.
Bust them!
Well, it's the week of the split. Honey Break's pretty much a ghost town. Everybody's kind of went home. First week of the split, it's 5 days in the middle of the season. Nobody can hunt. A lot of people have went home, and a couple of us stayed back. We got a lot of stuff to do before we open up. About to go cut some brush, meet up with Jeremy, and then we got some deer hunters in camp. Drew's been getting ready for them all week. He's been deer hunting, scouting every day. So Drew's probably out there right now in a stand somewhere.
Well, it's the split time, the duck split in Louisiana, but it's not the deer split. So most of the guys went back home to check on everything, check on their girlfriends or wives, see mama, and take care of the business. A handful of them stayed back to do a little prep work in the field before the second split starts back Saturday. We've got a few deer hunters in here at the lodge. We've got Jay and Cindy Lash, they're partners with Lego Creek Blinds. Yeah, they built our skid blinds for us, and we got some floating blinds. They're out here on their big buck hunt. So we sat on this stand the other day and did a little scouting, a little recon work, and had 14 different bucks show up. Old Blaze was one of them. And Jay put one through the wheelhouse of old Blaze and ended up being a 290-pound Louisiana swamp donkey. For our little duck opener, we've got some of our partners from Realtree and Purina coming in, and from the Hill Family Estate Wine Group, and that's our new wine partner. Might even get Tyler on a buck. He's kind of got his eyes on the little buck we call Drury Jr. He's a real tall eight with some cool little junk. Looking forward to that this weekend. Shoot ducks in the morning and bucks in the evening.
If you just go to the camp right now, you could probably see a tumbleweed going across it. There's hardly anybody there. It's pretty quiet. But across the levee here, we're all rebrushing blinds, making sure the decoys are good, making sure we get all the floaters out that is in the right spot, just getting it ready for our next group of hunters. You get a lot of messages from your buddies. They have a hard day on the river. They're just not flying right, and you post it, a big strap full of ducks. You're back at 9 o'clock in the morning, and they send you a text. So it must be nice. It must be nice. So, well, it is nice, but you come down here and work with us for a day or so. At home, we're chasing birds all over the public woods there. If you don't want to go in, you don't have to. If you want to go in late, you can. If you don't want to go at all, you can. You don't have to do it. But when you're working 26,000 acres, there's no days off. So them buddies that call in tell you how lucky you are, it just makes you laugh. The work that goes into this, I'll trade spots any day. Decoys out. We got the brines brushed up pretty good. There's a lot of ducks trying to come back in. We're gonna go ahead and get out of here and let them come on in, feed, and rest the rest of the night. And we're gonna be here first thing in the morning. Give it to them.
Here comes old Sweet Pea! Sweet Pea!
It's opening day of the second split. Birds has had 5 days of rest. The guides has had 3 days of rest. Worked hard Thursday and Friday getting everything back ready. It's time to go in there and make the sky fall. We are going to have a west wind. This kind of may switch out to northwest a little bit that we do have, so they may kind of want to come over back. I'm ready to watch them get up there and do like that. Fall. Finish. Do it right. Let's go get them.
Man, we're here at the duck shed this morning. Everybody's excited. It's been 5 days of no duck hunting. The split's finally over, season's back open. Everybody's fired up, getting geared up, getting our bikes going and getting our dogs picked up. Fixing to head over to the lodge and get our clients and get this party started.
Going with Jared today, the master, Master Blaster, Jared Moffitt. Opening day of the second split. Conditions ain't wonderful, weather, the ducks are good. So we're gonna be all right. We're gonna shoot them.
Well, it's the first day after the split. We're all excited to get back to going. We've got a fresh set of customers. Should have plenty of ducks after they've been rested for a week, so we're anxious to get after them.
Yeah, so today's the first day back from the split. It's been a ghost town in here, really. We just had some deer hunters, but I'm happy to see clients in here thriving, getting ready to go hunt some ducks.
Just gonna go try to shoot a couple ducks in the fog this morning. Feet hanging, we banging. You cannot use that. Chip, you can't use that.
Well, this is a little daily routine. Once we get to the blind, we come out here and we work these decoys a little bit, get it set up for the right wind. While the clients are in the blind, relaxing, visiting, we have a little safety meeting, talk about the hunt and what we expect and what the wind is. And shooting your zones 10 to 2, let us call a shot and get everything ready and prepared and just tell them what we expect it's going to be. Like this morning, we got a little fog. Hopefully it burns off quick and get it done and make the sky fall.
Well, this morning, we got plenty of ducks, but we ain't got enough wind. So that's obviously going to stall us. Decoys aren't moving. We're going to have to make it work, though, regardless. Cody this morning said he was going to try using a jerk string, so I'm kind of curious to see what he does and how much difference it makes.
As duck hunters, we like wind. We don't have a lot of wind, so I've rigged up a simple jerk string. It's just got an anchor and an elastic cord, and what that'll do is make a lot of movement out here on the water. That movement is the first thing that the ducks can spot. This string is gonna have 4 or 5 these little old decoys on it, and I'm gonna end up running it all the way back up here to the blind. So I'll manually be pulling on this thing, making some waves. Keeps it realistic, and hopefully they'll come land right here in front of the blind. Kill one.
Kill the one, right in the hole, right in the hole. Right there, kill him, kill him, kill him, kill him, kill him. There he's up. Good. Run!
We got a full duck blind this morning. Drew and I are sharing a blind this morning. We got two key partnerships with us. We've got Purina with us this morning and the Realtree guys. So two vitally super important partnerships to Honeybright. So it's kind of nice to be able to share a duck blind with Carl Gunger and Brad Shore from Realtree. So Purina's been a vital role in our dog conditioning down here for, I guess, 3 years now, Carl. Yeah. You know, you don't ever see any sick dogs or anything. I mean, we keep a good clean kennel, but our right now. Right here. That other one's ran us over. Carl, tell us a little bit about what's the science behind ProPlan.
Well, it was designed as a performance dog food. So for people that compete and have dogs that perform, run hard, field trialers, whether they're, you know, bird dogs, retrievers, whatever, you know, a high fat, high protein really helps improve a dog's stamina, helps their conditioning, lean muscle mass so they can perform. So just like a human athlete, these dogs need, you know, good nutrition.
So you take a dog that's, you know, 6, 7, 8 years old, if he's not been well taken care of, his career's over.
That's right.
Well, down here, we're hunting storm 7 or 8. We've got zinc hunting. These guys are still at the top of their game.
Yep.
And they're 7, 8, 9 years old.
That's right.
Well, you can't do that if you're not taken care of them.
Yeah, for sure.
And Purina takes care of them. So yep. It's vitally important.
Yeah. There's a lot of research that's shown dogs fed a good food, a high protein, and lean muscle mass, there are fewer injuries. So it's important to feed a good food.
It's been a really good partnership, and we really appreciate having it. Out front, out front.
To the right, Carl.
To the right.
Shoot him, 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 shoot him. Behind you, behind you, behind you. Shoot the duck, shoot.
Okay, KK, what's the deal?
I'm letting Carl have it. I'm not reloading my gun.
I just want to. I want y'all to let the duck have it.
I'm a duck lover. Man.
That was a banded, double banded blue wing tail with a cell phone. Full plumage. Y'all let it go.
Hey, David.
Yes, sir.
You need me to come down there?
Hey, I can't get him much closer than that, David.
Well, if I could just get Brad Shore to hit something, we'll be doing all right.
I'm talking about. It's raining dust. Hallelujah. It's better than me, and he said.
Hey, what? Fire, fire.
I think I did. He went, poof. Did you see it? yeah, Bud got out. Look at that picture Bud got. Poof. He imploded.
Y'all kill him. We got pintails, gadwalls, shovelers, mallards. Deal. A whole bunch of smiles. Piles make smiles.
Shoot him, shoot him, shoot him.
Well, 11 mallards. We're one short of having a limit. We're getting closer. Kind of like Johnny Cash Cadillac, one piece at a time.
Landon, you got him.
You got him. Got him.
Watch him.
Yes, sir. That's a route. We knocked him on out.
Well, first time hunting at Honeybright. Been down here many times, but now I know what they're talking about when you come in here and basically limit out with a seven man limit and before 8:30. So ducks continue to fly out there right now. Just had four mallards, just tried to light in here while we were packing everything up with my trash bag sitting right here, and they were still wanting to light. So pretty amazing place. Obviously it's all about the experience, and these guys certainly got it figured out. So glad to be here.
You can try. Go ahead, give him all you got. That's how you kill them.
Hey, that a boy.
Buck! As my buddy said the other day, I had a group, they was all boom, 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 boom on the water. I said, watch back. Boom, kill one. Boom, kill one. D.A. said, dang, how you do that? My buddy looked at him and said, he kills for a living now. I can't expect you to see.